A year to, let's say, 16 months ago, if anyone were to coin the term
critical race theory,
critical race theory,
according to critical race theory,
the term critical race theory has gotten a lot of attention recently.
Most people would be like, wondering, what on earth are you talking about?
What is that?
But of recent, it seems to be all the rage nowadays.
Everyone is talking about it. You may have heard of it, you may have talked about it, but you may not know what it is, why it's so hot, why everyone is jumping in.
As it's become a massive talking point for those, let's say, on the Patriot side of the game and your right wingers and bootlicks to throw in.
You're crazy. Am I? Yes. Am I? Yes. Am I?
So, what is CRT, or critical race theory?
Scholars of critical race theory define it as recognizing race as a social construct, but one that's been deeply embedded in American institutions throughout history.
And to be honest, if I was to go into it into immense detail, this video would be epic. As in, this video would end up being very, very long. So I try my best to
keep it short and sweet.
Because I know,
ain't got all day.
So, CRT, critical race theory, is a concept that was brought about by
one scholar in particular who is kind of, I think it's fair to say, is kind of the pioneer forefather scholar of CRT, which is Derrick Bell, a man named Derrick Bell, who was at Harvard, a law scholar. I'll talk more about law in a minute. But he was one who started to publish some texts, books like And We Are Not Saved or Faces at the Bottom of the Well, which started to open up this conversation. Critical race theory emerged out of critical law studies and people like Derrick Bell and then also Kimberly Crenshaw, who is another kind of pioneering important figure. They're law scholars, really, really serious law scholars. And so critical legal studies is a broad field. Critical race theory then took that broad approach towards law, the critical approach towards law, but specifically circumscribed their questions around the question of race, racism, disparities, prejudice, that kind of thing.
And in a nutshell, they wrote a paper basically expressing how certain laws and practices written back in those days were highly discriminatory, towards black people, and which how these certain laws, let's say, had an impact on the black community in comparison to their white counterparts.
Why are there still so many racial disparities in things like incarceration rates, health, crime, wealth and income, housing, de facto segregation in cities, that kind of stuff? Why, along all of these things that are measurable and quantifiable, why are there massive racial gaps a full generation after all these supposed huge racial justice victories in the courts, in the law, in the policies? A full generation after all these supposed huge racial justice victories in the courts, in the law, in the policies?
Yet, the term itself, in my opinion, is somewhat, let's say, ambiguous, disingenuous, because it has this notion based in it that the events that actually did happen and took place back in those days are considered to be theories.
I will spend the rest of my life here in Texas trying to teach evolution to creationists. Evolution isn't an opinion, it's fact.
And as we know, theories are unknowns that are supported by simulated knowns presented in a hypothesis as a known, yet the truth is still unknown.
If you didn't get it, lie down and then figure the shit out when you get home.
And in the same way that Black Lives Matter was skewered,
I'm talking about the Black Lives Matter movement's three founders and their stated objectives, political goals, their motivations, the fact that they identify as Marxist, trained Marxists, they call themselves.
Critical race theory has undergone a brutal attack of discreditation, to which it is now seen as
boogeyman, you nailed the window shut,
to society because
it's basically white shaming. And that's basically a racist viewpoint.
Saying it pushes the idea that white people are inherently racist and people of color inherently oppressed.
Yet, at its roots, it just highlights some home truths, such as redlining.
The FHA created low-interest mortgages to build homes across the country. This agency actually built the suburbs as we know it. They basically said, hey banks, if someone applies for a mortgage, go ahead, build them a house. Even if they don't pay you back, we'll still guarantee a loan. Unless they're black.
Which had an impact on wealth generation within the black community.
For y'all who don't know, home ownership is the primary driver of wealth. And who has a harder time getting homes?
Black people?
Bingo.
You also had, let's say, segregation, right? And how white kids were taught by
the gravitational forces of the entire mass overcoming the electromagnetic forces of individual atoms and so collapsing inwards. If the star is massive enough, it will continue this collapse, creating a black hole.
Whilst black kids were taught by
lovely Lillian.
Oh, Lillian, you look wonderful.
Thank you, Sam.
Lillian will sing the ever-popular Transylvania 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
When you're down in Transylvania and the night begins to fall, you might get to feeling lonely. If you do, give me a call. Just dial Transylvania 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Which impacted their opportunities in the higher spectrum of the, let's say, job market. When it comes to the higher spectrum of the jobs available, this impacted their opportunities for that because of the
vast disparities between how suburban schools that serve lots of white kids are funded and urban schools that serve lots of black and Latino kids are funded. And that all goes back to the legacy of redlining.
Things like the crime bill.
Of the 1994 crime bill, was it $12 billion that was authorized for states across the country that would enact what's called truth in sentencing laws. That funding literally paid states to increase the number of prison beds that they allocated for individuals convicted of violent crime in this country to serve 85% of their sentences behind bars. The reason that provision is so important and the reason we're still talking about it today is the federal government essentially subsidized states across the country to build more prisons. Subsidized states across the country to build more prisons.
For African American men with very low levels of schooling, so if we think about black men who were born in the late 1970s, and who are growing up through the American prison boom of the 1980s and the 1990s, the chances that they're going to serve time in state or federal prison if they dropped out of high school is about 70%. So going to prison for that group of black men with very low levels of schooling,
Transylvania 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
That's become a normal life event. And that's really only happened in the last 10 years.
The crime bill that saw black people going to jail.
I hereby sentence you to serve 125 years in the custody of the Commissioner of the Department of Corrections.
For minor incidences and occurrences.
You got a broken taillight back there. Can I see some ID?
And though the paper was written over 50 years ago now, people say, is it still relevant today? And I ask, well, is racism still here?
This is what I call a predicament. So I gotta let him in.
So the question becomes now, why is it that the patriots and those on the right wing side of the game and your bootlicks and blah blah blah, why do they want to discredit critical race theory so bad?
CRT is racist. It is abusive. It discriminates against one's color. Let me educate you. An honest dialogue does not oppress. An honest dialogue does not implement hatred or injustice. It's to communicate without deceiving people. Today, we don't need your agreement. We want action and a backbone for what we ask for today, to ban CRT.
Shut the f-
One reason, in my opinion, is so that white people can continue to, let's say, define history through a white rose-tinted lens, right? In which they can, let's say, eradicate the of history that they were involved in, yeah? While promoting all the good bits that they're involved in, you know what I'm saying?
Much more is taught about the history of black slave traders who existed before and after the transatlantic slave trade. Before and after the transatlantic slave trade.
So, for example, they will teach that British ended slavery, right? Totally sidestepping that the British played an integral role in the slave trade itself. You know what I'm saying?
In the 17th century, a rough family of London cloth cutters called Beckford emigrated to the newly conquered colony of Jamaica to seek its fortune. The Beckfords invested in sugar and slaves.
Up, on your feet, on your feet.
Then we have what I call the causes for victimhood mentality, or that victimhood mindset, yeah?
How do I have two medical degrees if I'm sitting here oppressed? How do I get, first of all, time up, we've only got 5 minutes now, not 5 minutes, two medical...
In which, those on the right-hand side of the game will admit that, you know, there was discrimination back 50 years ago. They weren't going to deny that. But it's not like that now, right? Everything's kumbaya and equal, right? Yet, this is still apparent.
If your hair is relaxed, white people are relaxed. Your hair is nappy, they're not happy.
Just yesterday, my daughter came into the house and said, "Daddy, how come I don't have good hair?" I wonder how she came up with that idea.
Within the black community, if you have good hair, you're prettier or better than. The lighter, the brighter, the better.
They want to go like this, like Farrah Fawcett.
There's so many pressures to straighten your hair.
Look at my ring.
And this ideal is still knocking about.
I'm strong, y'all. I'm very strong. I can sleep in a bucket. I'm fast. I got stamina.
I know I don't look it, but
I know magic.
My worst quality is that I'm a perfectionist.
Have I mentioned this? Docile. I am agreeable to a fault. You should have seen the dude who asked me to get on the boat when we came over here.
Not a violent bone in my body. I just walked right on.
No big deal. Never seen a boat in my life.
In which I see as black people shouldn't have to go to that extra mile, that extra 1 or 2 miles, in fact, yeah? Just to be considered or seen as equal-ish. You know what I mean?
I get it. We've always been told, black people, you've got to work 10 times as hard as your next colleague or something like that. The person telling me that, that's your level of ignorance. I'm going to work 10 times as harder as the next person because I know where I want to be. Not because that person is white and I'm black and I need to work harder than them. No, I'm going to work harder than them because it's a job satisfaction for myself.
I am agreeable to a fault. You should have seen the dude who asked me to get on the boat.
As critical race theory, in my view and how I see it, it's not about, let's say, stopping black people from achieving. It's not about, you know, black people failing or not being able to get ahead in life. Yeah. It's about the hurdles and the hoops and all the extras that we have to do just to get the same result or get to the same place.
Do you understand?
Yes.
So, for example, let's imagine two people going from A to B, and en route there's a gate, a river to cross, and let's say a 100-mile piece of road to go down.
I'm listening.
Person A is given a key, yeah, has access to a boat, right, and also access to a car to do that 100-mile journey, whilst person B has a crowbar, yeah, has to build a raft, and to do that 100-mile journey, they are given a bicycle with some deflated tires on it.
I'm listening.
This doesn't mean that person B can't get to point B. It's just going to be a lot more difficult to get there because of the obstacles and the hurdles that are in the way.
Do you understand?
Yes.
Therefore, person A has no right to project any notion that person B is, let's say, lazy or slow, uneducated, not fit, or whatever it is, negative thing that you can think of, right, for getting to point B so much later than they did, right? Simply because person A had, let's say, all the doors open for them.
I generally come in at least 15 minutes late. I use the side door, that way Lumberg can't see me. and after that, I just sort of space out for about an hour.
Space out?
Yeah, I just stare at my desk, but it looks like I'm working.
But what if you were offered some kind of a stock option equity sharing program? Would that do anything for you?
You know what I mean? Just to make it simple.
Clever.
And the truth is, let's be real, this is a reality for a majority of white people, whether it comes via, let's say, nepotism or something like that, right? It's a reality because you know, at the end of the day, certain doors will be open for you because the system itself has been done that way in your favor. You know what I mean? Right? In the same way that, let's say, rich kids, or so say, kids that have rich parents can pay for them to get into university, yeah, have an advantage or have an easier path than, let's say, a poor child that wants to get into university that can't afford the fees and stuff. You know what I'm saying?
Super ultra rich parents were paying schools, bribing coaches, paying off people at the SATs to take the test for their kids or fudge the numbers.
And finally, as for critical race theory being somewhat divisive, to be honest with you, I kind of agree on that. But not in the same way as the portrayed view, right? And I'll use this analogy. So let's say that you're a single man and throughout that period of time, you never put down a toilet seat in your life, right? You get into a relationship with a woman and she has a thing about toilet seats being up, right? I don't know. She just doesn't like it. It's not aesthetically good. And, you know, it makes the bathroom look messy or she don't want to look down there and see your crap in there, right? Whatever. But the thing is, she wants you to put the toilet seat down. Now, throughout the honeymoon period of the relationship, she never said nothing because, you know, through the honeymoon period, everything's crisp. Everything's always nice in that honeymoon period. No one could do nothing wrong. But 3 months to 6 months later, it starts to annoy her. So she brings it up and she asks you as the male to put down the toilet seat. Now, you can take this one or two ways. You can either acknowledge her request and think, well, okay then, no harm, no foul to me. Therefore, I'll do something about it. I'll try my best in the future to address the situation. Or you can, let's say,
you can have a number two, a plain omelet that comes with cottage fries and rolls.
Yeah, I know what it comes with, but it's not what I want.
You see that sign, sir? Yes, you all have to leave. I'm not taking any more of your smartness and sarcasm.
You see this sign?
And argue that, well, I've never put down a seat, and I don't have a problem with it. And if you don't like it, that's on you, right? But I'm not changing and I'm not gonna do anything about it. Now, when it comes to CRT and let's say the racial tension that was happening in society as we see it now being played out, what we have is the latter in that situation, in which how I view it is that you have a lot of, let's say your patriots and that, they don't want to see any change, right? And the thing is, because they're in the position now where their forefathers and the forefathers before that gave them this advantage, yeah, as subtle as it may be and as huge it may be, the advantage that they've had, they don't want to acknowledge that as their reason for being where they are now. And they don't want to address the issues, because if you address the issues, that means that the people that were disadvantaged have an opportunity to empower themselves and become, let's say, equal or to the same level. And they don't want that. They really don't want that. And there we have it. My take on CRT. Whether you agree or disagree, you know what to do. Leave a comment in the comments below. And don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. I'm out. Peace.
Yes. Am I?
Yes.
Am I?
Yes.